From 1955 onwards, the colossal B-52 Stratofortress became the primary long-range heavy bomber of the U.S. Air Force, and as the Cold War continued, it was modified and employed for many different purposes, many of which were classified. The upgraded B-52C was one of them, and it was used in the 1960s to carry a strange and one-of-a-kind payload known as the Flashback Test Vehicle. Rumors quickly spread that the device was a heavier and more powerful nuclear warhead than the world's most lethal atomic weapon, the Soviet Tsar Bomba, which had an explosive yield of 50 megatons. Still, stakes ran high during the Cold War, and the United States government had to secretly develop their most ambitious project yet, a 100-megaton bomb that used this unique device as a means to test the bomb's yield without the Soviets finding out about it. The 100-megaton bomb. During the last months of 1958, the Soviet Union and the United States agreed to a voluntary test ban moratorium. The nuclear arms race had reached a breaking point, and both governments were preoccupied with possible atomic havoc. As part of this test moratorium, both nations' lethal stockpiles would keep growing, but when it came to innovating with warheads to develop more powerful payloads, studies and tests would cease. However, everything would change in August of 1961 when Nikita Khrushchev decided to resume Soviet nuclear testing. He would later claim that he was pressured by the Soviet military and scientific brass. At the same time, those around him would say that Khrushchev wanted to impose himself over President John F. Kennedy. The situation also escalated after the Berlin incidents, in which the Soviet soldiers began building the Berlin Wall to prevent the East German populace from fleeing into the American sector. A Soviet statement then claimed that, quote, "The Soviet Union has worked out designs for creating a series of super-powerful nuclear bombs of 20, 30, 50, and 100 million tons of TNT. Meanwhile, the Kennedy administration also stated that it would resume nuclear testing, as the Atomic Energy Commission was not impressed by the Soviet plans to build 100-megaton weapons. American scientists could build them if they wanted, but many saw it as a waste of resources, as these giant bombs were impractical and strategically pointless. Such reasoning came from how the blast damage increases with yield. A 100-megaton bomb could release 10 times more energy than a 10-megaton bomb, but it would not produce 10 times more damage. Through testing, scientists discovered that the blast effects of explosions scaled as a cubic root and not linearly. This meant that a 100-megaton bomb would only produce twice the damage of a 10-megaton bomb. Consequently, deploying multiple low-yield nuclear weapons was easier and cheaper than focusing more resources on a bomb that would produce less blast damage. The Emperor Bomb. The Soviet Union's 100-megaton bomb program advanced quickly, despite multiple White House and United Nations statements advocating for a halt. Nuclear testing began in September of 1961 with multiple weekly exercises, detonating bombs with a nuclear yield from 1 to 12 megatons. Then, in October, Khrushchev announced that the Soviet Union was almost ready to detonate the most powerful bomb ever fielded. During his speech to the convocation of the 22nd Congress of the Communist Party, he said, quote, "We shall evidently round out the tests by exploding a hydrogen bomb equivalent to 50 million tons of TNT. We have said that we have a bomb as powerful as 100 million tons of TNT. And we have it, too. But we are not going to explode it, because even if exploded in the remotest of places, we are likely to break our own windows." On October 27th, the United Nations passed a resolution that appealed to the Soviet Union to refrain from testing such a weapon, but it fell on deaf ears. 3 days later, on October 30th, the Soviet Union carried out the desired test. The 50-million-ton bomb was named Tsar Bomba, or Emperor Bomb, weighed some 60,000 pounds, and had a length of 8 meters. Only a Tupolev Tu-95V aircraft could carry the Tsar Bomba, and it flew with the payload to State Test Site No. 6 on Novaya Zemlya, where it was successfully detonated at 13,000 feet. The 50-megaton bomb fulfilled its objective and had a blast yield of 50 megatons of TNT. As the Soviet leader had stated, glass windows were shattered in every building located 480 miles from the detonation. Moreover, the flare was visible from more than 620 miles away, and the world was in utter shock. American nuclear tests. President Kennedy and his administration were not kidding when they said the United States could produce a 50-megaton nuclear device. Going back to the early 1950s, the Strategic Air Command, or SAC, had come up with some exciting ideas. Some of them were scrapped after President Dwight D. Eisenhower limited the megatonnage to 15 megatons, or 1,000 times more devastating than the Hiroshima bomb. However, in November of 1961, interest in developing a nuclear weapon more potent than the Tsar Bomba was revitalized. Atomic Energy Commission Chairman Glenn Seaborg suggested to President Kennedy that a 50 or 100 megaton bomb was feasible. Seaborg then met with Lieutenant General Austin Betts, the Deputy Director of Military Applications at the AEC, to discuss the plans. Sandia National Laboratory, which specialized in everything related to nuclear weaponry, suggested that a bomb of 30 or 50 megatons could be successfully deployed by a B-52 aircraft. However, Sandia also pointed out that the bomb would require drogue parachutes for the pilots to survive the danger zone. A series of nuclear tests then followed to develop the desired bomb. The first was Operation Nougat, which lasted from September of 1961 to June of 1962. Such tests were conducted underground at the Nevada test site. They were followed by Operation Dominic, which began in April and ended in October of 1962. It comprised over 30 bomb tests at Kiribati and Johnston Atoll in the Pacific. Following the trials, Seaborg told Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara that the United States was ready to develop an American Tsar Bomba. Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. Although the continuous nuclear tests and the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962 almost brought the U.S. and the USSR to full-on war, the situation soon de-escalated, and the AEC turned its focus to the bomb designs. One such design called to experiment with the ripple concept in order to create a lighter bomb, while another proposed to enlarge the already existing but highly classified Mark 41 weapon. In early 1963, there was an intense debate between McNamara and the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The AEC and the military top brass wanted to continue testing their nuclear bomb, while other diplomats were advocating for the Limited Test Ban Treaty with the USSR to ban atmospheric testing. In March, Ross Gilpatrick, the Deputy Secretary of Defense, summed up the situation to Seaborg and the AEC by saying, quote, "It is our desire to obtain the maximum yield possible compatible with the B-52 bomber without requiring further nuclear tests." Still, while trying to find a quick solution to the problem, Seaborg and the AEC stumbled upon something quite interesting that Sandia National Laboratory had been working on. The Big Test Vehicle. Sandia had developed a new way of testing known as UTVs, or Universal Test Vehicles. These UTVs had fusing equipment and standardized ballistics to deliver any type of bomb for testing purposes. The original UTV was the size of an American B-53 bomb. For a higher yield weapon, Sandia was developing the BTV, or Big Test Vehicle, which had roughly the same size as the 50-megaton Mark 41 bomb that the AEC had envisioned to be carried by a B-52 Stratofortress. The BTV weighed about 25,000 pounds, was 310 inches long, and had a diameter of 76 inches. It also had the shape of a giant cylinder and required a special transporter. Another of Sandia's innovations was the FTV, or Flashback Test Vehicle. It was developed for Project Baker, or Operation Flashback, whose objective was to prepare a test for a high-yield bomb if atmospheric testing was resumed. Such a device was an airdropped gravity bomb with a yield of 50 to 100 megatons, that would be used if the Soviets decided to break the Limited Test Ban Treaty. The Flashback Test Vehicle was 297 inches long and had a diameter of 96 inches, without counting its parachute pack. It weighed 36,000 pounds, which was considerably larger than the Big Test Vehicle, given its size. As the US and USSR began negotiating the Limited Test Ban Treaty to ban atmospheric nuclear testing, Sandia and the AEC began secretly experimenting with the FTV. But if word got out, the treaty and the negotiations with the Soviets could immediately crumble. The Flashback Test Vehicle. President Kennedy advocated for peace with the USSR and prioritized the treaty, which went against what the head of Strategic Air Command, Curtis LeMay, wanted. Still, he claimed that he would be satisfied if the AEC could develop a 50-megaton bomb without testing. The Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty was signed on August 5, 1963. Still, the victory was short-lived for President Kennedy, as he would be assassinated 3 months later. From then on, global tensions escalated for the United States, including in Vietnam. The presence of U.S. military advisors increased in the country, bringing the U.S. one step closer to war in Indochina to stop the spread of communism. The Flashback Test Vehicle was eventually tested for the first time in January of 1965 at Kirtland Air Force Base in New Mexico. However, these tests did not involve dropping the bomb. Instead, the focus was to test the susceptibility of the Flashback device to electromagnetic emissions from the ARC-58 transmitter of the B-52 aircraft and the Flashback's own telemetry transmissions. A simulator replaced the warhead during the flight, and in order to accommodate the FTV, the doors from the B-52 bomb bay had to be removed, while a portion of the device protruded from the aircraft's belly. From the little information known about the weapon, the FTV's round-nosed cone resembled the Mark VI vehicle from the Titan II missile, while its cylindrical section had a tapered tail section with three wedge-like tail fins. Plus, antennas protruded from its rear, serving as telemetry transmitters. Finally, the device's parachute package was also located on its tail section. Operation Paddle Wheel. After the 1966 tests, Sandia experts used the FTV for wind tunnel testing at the Cornell Aeronautical Laboratory. The wind tunnel models of the B-52 and the FTV were built from aluminum and supplied by Sandia. During the trials, the scientists determined the aerodynamics of the FTV inside the B-52 bomb bay and during the drop. The Flashback test vehicle was intended to be used over Johnston Atoll in September of 1967 as part of Operation Paddle Wheel, but it is unknown if such a drop ever occurred. Whichever the case, Sandia's objective regarding the Flashback vehicle was to drop it with a parachute to fulfill its purpose of a laydown bomb that would gently hit the ground and explode after a specific period of time so that the pilots could safely escape the targeted area. During the height of the Vietnam War, some scientists suggested dropping FTVs with gasoline on top of the hostile Viet Cong and North Vietnamese to analyze their blast capability of some 20 tons of TNT. However, this never happened, as Sandia gave its big test vehicle transporter to NASA in 1976, where it would be used to test parachute test vehicles for the space shuttle program. Thank you for watching my video. Please like and subscribe to our Dark Documentaries channels to find more exciting historical content. And don't forget to hit the bell icon to be notified of our newest videos. Stay tuned.